Hello, everybody. Welcome back from our Crash Bandicoot 100%. As you saw, as I did cut in the end of the last episode, where we finally beat Fumbling in the Dark, we now head on to Castle Machinery. Now, I want to make something known again. I mean, yeah, we did just do this, basically. But last time, as you saw in the end of it, we took the green gem upward, and you get a bunch of lives, which is nice. So now we have 45. That well makes up for Fumbling in the Dark's death-defying jumps that I happened to make. So pretty much what happened in Fumbling in the Dark, if I didn't explain in the last video, which I might have forgotten to say, what ended up happening was I got so close to the end of the level, and I just ended up falling down and just dying. Like, I was right there. I had, like, those three spiders left to go, and I just ended up dying. And it was such a morale breaker, you know? Like, one of those, you get so close to beating it, and all of a sudden you just die, and you're like, well, I don't feel like playing this anymore. But fortunately for me, I love Crash Bandicoot 1 just enough, and I love you guys just enough to continue this and beat this game 100%, because, let's face it, we have one of three hard levels completed, and we have the first hardest level completed, which in my opinion is Fumbling in the Dark. We have also, and this is all my opinion, of course, obviously, Slippery Climb, I'd say, is probably the second hardest, and the third hardest being the lab. If I had to, like, base every level in order from, like, hardest, from, like, easiest to hardest, I don't know. I mean, because if you think about it, Insanity Beach, like, even trying to 100% that one's pretty difficult if you think about it, because, you know, you have that one section, that one row of boxes that you have to, you know, break, and if you mess up, you mess up. You're kind of screwed on that, but if you have the, you know, the triple Aku masks, you should be fine and able to run on it just fine, but some people don't know that, and I didn't know that at the beginning either. And I was one of those very few people, or very, I should say very many people, I'm sure, that probably thought that you have to jump on the boxes. And that's utterly kind of what got me screwed over. Now, Castle Machinery, even though, like, we are in the, you know, the final levels of the game, and we are on the castle levels pretty much, and you would think, like, since it's kind of, you know, the final bout, you would probably think that all these levels are practically really hard, considering the fact that Jaws of Darkness was, well, decently difficult, and then, you know, you have, you know, Fumbling in the Dark and Lights Out and all that good stuff here too. Well, I don't know. I mean, there's a few levels on this island I feel like are just kind of easy, which is something I do like about Crash Bandicoot 1, is they don't just throw out difficult levels just because. It's not one of those, you know, this is World 8, it's gonna be as hard as hell, you know. None of that crap. It's more like, we're just gonna put these levels here just because. I mean, they do try to, you know, give you much more difficulty later on, but I also feel like they give you a lot more difficult things to do, even in the beginning of the game. Because if you're trying to 100% the game, that's where the difficulty really comes into play. And, oh my god, I hate this one. So basically, what I do is I try to take this one box at a time, as you saw there. I almost died. I almost literally just died right there. You can make that path just fine. I don't know how the fuck that... Can I even make that jump? Was that even a jump I could make? I mean, that looked like I could make that. Maybe I was supposed to wait. That's probably what I was supposed to do. I don't remember. You guys gotta remember, I haven't played this for a long time. By play this for a long time, I mean actually go through the game 100%. Because it's been quite some time. Usually, when I try to go back and play this game 100%, I end up kind of just quitting, like, halfway through. Not because, you know, I don't want to, it's just because I'm just like, actually it's more because I don't want to. It's like I just get bored or something like that, or I just don't feel like there's really any reason to. Because basically I play Crash Bandicoot, oddly enough, as a stress reliever, which is strange. I mean, well, I used to play it a lot as a stress reliever. I mean, everybody has their own, that was my fault. Everybody has their own, like, little things that they like to do, and video games are kind of like my small little bit of an escape, so to speak. You know, I just play video games because I enjoy video games. I'm very passionate about playing video games. And I mean, I do really want to make games, and me and my friend were trying to make some games and stuff. We tried a few times here and there, and just not necessarily utterly failed, but just kind of either quit or just give up, or end up arguing with each other about something stupid and something like that, and just kind of sucks the fun out of it, you know? We just want something to go one way, and somebody else just disagrees with it, and we just can't seem to agree to disagree for some reason, even though I'm trying the hardest I can, but it's kind of hard to want to be able to do that too. Like, I don't like people telling me that my idea is wrong, but at the same time, it's like, you know, if it's wrong, it's wrong. There's just nothing I can do about it. Like, if it doesn't work, if it doesn't fit, then it doesn't fucking fit, you know? But I don't know. It's difficult. Like, we really want to make... I don't really talk about this very much. I didn't really try to talk about it very much, even when we were doing it. But we were trying to make a 2D platformer that we had a really good idea going for it, too. You know, like a 2D side-scroller. And we could do it. We have the essential tools, sort of. I mean, at first we wanted to make it kind of like a... like an odd art style. But, just like our... like his... basically, he was going to draw it. Like, we wanted to make it to where it was his own kind of design style. Like, we designed the characters together, but, like, in game-wise, it would be a specific, you know, almost Shantae-looking kind of, like, character-esque style going on there. But we decided to go on, you know, 2D-bit instead. Because, I mean, 8-bit kind of... 8-bit kind of seems to work a little bit better than most. And somebody just called me, apparently. Like, right when I was recording. That's not good. I get these weird fucking calls from, like, all over the place. Well, unfortunately for them, I am a Let's Player, and I'm not going to answer the call, considering the fact. Not because I'm a douche, but I don't know anybody in Arizona, by the way. And I also don't really, you know, answer these kind of calls, because they're probably telemarketers or something like that. Watch, it's probably like my dad or something, like, all the way in Arizona trying to contact me. Well, if it was, I would eventually find... oh, you can't make that. I'm just stupid. I mean, like, a part of me really kind of wants to just go back and try to make this game, but at the same time, I don't know if he really wants to go the full mile with me, you know? That's the thing, too, is kind of worried about that. Kind of just fight and bicker a lot and kind of just... well, that'd have made things a little harder for everybody, you know? Oh, motherfucker, now they give me a voicemail, too. This motherfucker needs to just stop, like, I swear to God. You know what would be really weird? What would be honestly really weird is, like, if it's some kind of, like, really creepy stalker or some shit. I mean, if that was the point, then I'm gonna kill this guy. This guy's gotta go. Okay, I'm kidding. I'm not gonna kill anybody, per se, but, you know. That would just be fucked. That'd be fucked up, because I usually get the same calls from Arizona. It's really starting to piss me off. I'm about to just block it, just completely. That way I just never get these fucking calls again. Again, it's probably just some stupid fucking scam telemarketer thing. I was actually watching this video where this guy got a call, and it was from, well, it sounded like one of those Indian dudes, you know, from, like, the telemarketing things, too. And he got some call from them. This guy was a scammer. And it was funny, because, like, he was telling him, like, you know, you owe some money on the IRS or whatever. Like, you gotta pay this fee or some shit. Like, you know, you're in trouble with the IRS and what have you. He's trying to freak him out, you know. Trying to freak out, basically, older people and just gullible people in general. And it was funny, because, like, this guy, you know, he knew he was bullshit. He knew he was bullshit. And, basically, the dude on the phone was saying something like, you gotta go to Target, and you gotta buy $2,000 worth of gift cards. And you gotta give them to me, or something like that, or some shit. You know, he had, like, no idea how anything worked. Like, if somebody told me to go buy gift cards or whatever from Target to give to the IRS, that would probably be a pretty big red flag right there. It'd be like, yeah, I think you're lying. I definitely think you're lying. That's no doubt in my mind. I mean, eventually the guy just told him to fuck off, and, you know, this guy started arguing back. He's like, I get people all the time, you know, and all this other shit. I would probably do the voice, but I don't really feel like offending too many people now. I mean, typically, that's weird for me to say, isn't it? Because, like, typically, aren't I trying to be as offensive as possible on YouTube and just not care what people think? Well, yeah, I mean, I don't know. Like, I'm starting to get more subs and just like, eh. It's not that I'm not gonna change because, you know, people don't want to see. I mean, if somebody told me, like, stop doing that, I'd be like, well, fuck you then. You know, you're offended. I swear up and down all the time. That's just because, you know, it's a bad habit, of course, but it's a habit I can't seem to break, and I just finally just accepted because this is who I am. You know, regardless of what people tell me, what I'm going to be. Whoop. This is what I am, this is what I act like, so if you don't like it, I'm sorry. I'm not going to change my YouTube ways just because of YouTube. Like, if somebody doesn't like it, then dislike the video. Simple enough. That way I know that you don't like it, but at least then I know that you watched it. Because you gotta remember, if somebody dislikes the video, guess what? That means that they watched the video. You get a view! So that's always kind of nice. Come on, come on. Just come down. Thank you. Thing is, I really want to see... I love watching speedruns of Crash Bandicoot. I want to see some of those again, actually. Mainly this game. I love watching speedruns in general. Well, okay. I say that now, but it's funny because like for a while, I said I hate speedruns, but now it's more like, I'm starting to like them again. I mean, I used to actually do it, to be honest. I had my Twitch channel, which I don't go on anymore, but I had my Twitch channel where I would actually stream Jak and Daxter 100%. I beat it in like 2 hours, 2.5 hours worth, which was impressive considering, you know, me. But I guess recently they found a skip on Jak and Daxter 1 where you can basically skip the entire last cutscene. So that basically just breaks pretty much the whole game almost right there. That saves you a shitload of time. And that's ridiculous. The thing is, like, why I stopped speedrunning is because the competition, like, I only did it for fun for a little bit, and that's typically how I am. I usually just end up doing something for fun until I really latch onto it. You know I'm having a really good time if I do something like this. Like, I've been doing Let's Plays for, I think, by now, three or four years. I always say three because that's what I'm used to saying. But, not 3 years. It's been longer than that. I think I started doing Let's Plays since, like, 2011. I think that's when I started doing, like, Let's Plays stuff. Why do I always say 3 years for? God damn, I'm stupid. I guess more than that. I guess 5 or 6 years. And I've been on YouTube since 2008. I started... My YouTube channel's been here since 2008. It's like December something. I don't remember which December. Like, December 16th, maybe? Well, either way, I've been on YouTube for a long time. And I didn't start doing videos until like 2011, and then I think I started doing like actual Let's Plays since like maybe 2012. Let's Plays as in like commentary. I don't think I started doing commentary until like 2012-ish, maybe, give or take. Good thing about Nitrous Brio is he's pretty easy. Just mind where he's going to throw the stuff at and just watch out for the goop. You can't spin it, and that's going to come into play real soon. Like, once we get into the lab, which we're going to right now, once you're in the lab, this is where it's going to get a little bit more ridiculous with, you'll see what I'm talking about. That's one of the gimmicks of the lab that kind of pisses me off. It's like these moving platforms, these goddamn shockwaves here, too. Oh my god. Well, basically, pretty much, I'm just going to say this now, there's going to be a lot of those green goop things coming out because... Actually, to be fairly honest, well, it's not green goo, I guess the yellow ones. But pretty much, what I love about Crash Bandicoot 1 is the continuity. Like, it actually keeps a little bit of a continuity going with the characters. Like, Nitrous Brio just now shown off that there's, like, goo things coming out, and they actually have those show up in the next level. I love that, though. I really do like... I like how they don't have, like, these random enemies placed in, like, earlier levels just because. Now it's like they kind of have... It tells a story, but it doesn't, because you know, like you get close to the castle, you start seeing more spiders. You know, you get pretty close to like you get to these, well, what do you want to call them? Those Jaws of Darkness kind of levels, like those kind of not the dark levels, but the Jaws of Darkness style, like the temple levels. You know, you start seeing spiders in there too, and then they start coming out more. Like every level almost has its own kind of enemy, and I think the birds on Slippery Climb, I think they're only in that one level ever. From what I remember seeing them, you know, that's crazy. That's awesome. Most games are like, I mean, I don't mean to hash on these games, but I'm gonna use Mario as an example. Like Mario is like, you see Koopa shell, you see Koopas and Goombas quite a lot. I mean, yeah, the enemies start to get more aggressive, and not necessarily more aggressive, but you start to see more different variations of different types of enemies and what have you later on. But it's like, you know, you kind of get this. Well. You see Koopas and Goombas throughout, which, you know, I kind of like that. I kind of like how they keep older enemies, too. But something cool about Crash Bandicoot is, like, they change up the enemies almost for every level. Not exactly every level, but still. Now, this is hard. This right here is hard. And the reason why I find I had to shut up for a second so I can get that. The reason why I find that hard is because of these goddamn shocking dudes. It's these shocking dudes that always kill me. Now, here's another problem that I hate. It's these stupid, these yellow goo things. The reason why I hate them is because, like I said before, if you try to spin on them, they don't kill you or anything like that. I think if they touch you, you die. But if you spin on them, it's not going to do anything. Which, even then, you know, you'll spin backward, or you'll spin forward, depending on which way you're facing. And that could probably end up killing you. Okay, just wait for it to go. I think it's usually just three anyway. I think we did in the lab in a good set amount of run there. I think the TNT boxes might have exploded. Hopefully, please give me the perfect. Yes. Yes. Thank you. Okay. We have, I think, two more levels to go, and then I believe we're done. I think once we get these next two levels done, we're finally finished. And there's the yellow gem. 96% done. Awesome. Just fucking awesome. Wait a minute. I'm still missing boulders, aren't I? And I have the purple gem. Where did I get the purple gem at, actually? Where did I get the purple gem, I mean? I don't even remember. Oh, fuck. I actually don't remember where I got it at. Okay, so far everything here is completed, except for lights out. I guess we could add hell with it. We'll go do lights out real quick. I'm not going to go all the way back to the great gate right now, because lights out is right here. Fortunately for me, lights out is a little easier than fumbling in the dark, because if you ask me, I find, you know, fumbling in the dark ridiculously difficult. So that's the main three levels right now completed. The main three hardest levels completed. The lab, and fumbling in the dark, and slippery climb. Slippery climb is, of course, you know, the first one you see. Fumbling in the dark depends. I mean, depends on which way you go. I always count it as the second one because I want to get the key first. And then you got freaking the lab. And the lab, the only reason I find the lab so hard is because those stupid guys with the shock things. Not exactly the shock fences themselves, the electric fences themselves, but the guys with the electricity. I mean, the cool thing is, like I said before, like, you know, enemy placement is actually pretty cool in this game because we're starting to see guys in lab coats as we get closer to the castles, which I like that, though. Like I said before, like, Mario does the same thing, but I was mainly getting at with the Mario thing was, you know, it's just there's not a whole lot of, you know, they basically bring back, like, Goombas and Koopas, but, you know, they keep them throughout it, of course, which they keep some of the enemies here, too, you know, the rats and stuff, but I feel like every island almost has a different kind of enemy, so to speak. I mean, we've seen piranha plants, of course. I wouldn't say island. I guess different level has, like, their own different enemies. I like that. Because, like, you won't see piranha. Basically, what I'm saying is, if this was Mario, you would probably see Koopas here. You know what I'm saying? Like, you would see Koopas in the first level, and you would see Koopas here. But since, you know, Crash is a little bit different, of course, it's a completely different platformer. What I like about Crash is you don't see piranha plants here. Which, I mean, is completely out of place. But you could easily put it here, just put plants. You know, just spawning up randomly. That could work. Just have, like, you know, pots and stuff with piranha plants inside of them. That could work on the side of it. Actually, hell, that could be actually a pretty decent enemy placement, if you ask me. But, you know, I'm saying, like, they don't do that. And then again, they could easily put, you know, guys in lab coats in here, too. But they don't. That's what I'm getting at. People are probably going to think I'm saying it, saying, like, you know, I just don't like the Mario enemies or whatever. I just, hell, you know, sometimes I don't even know what I'm saying, but I have an idea what I'm getting at, but it's not coming out right, basically. Okay, so let's take the yellow gem up here, because that's the only time we're really going to get to see it. Do not jump off. Just stay here. You'll be fine. There's actually a warp pad up here, too. So grab these three boxes, and again, lights out is finished, because lights out is easy. Fortunately, it's much easier than fumbling in the dark. Like, that's another thing, too. The difficulty spike isn't too bad in Crash Bandicoot. I mean, yeah, you got Slippery Climb that comes out of nowhere and basically just shoots you up the ass. But, I mean, this I don't find too hard. And it kind of gives you an idea. Oh, that's where the purple gem was. Lights out. So there was a colored gem you get from getting another colored gem. Good thing we did lights out before I headed on any further, because that wouldn't have been good. So now we got the purple gem, we can go back to, I think, boulders, or it's the one before the second hog, when the one with the key. We gotta go back to second island. I think so. Let's see. How many islands are there? Like three, I think? Yeah, I think so. Yeah, because this is where Ripperoo's at. I guess I think Ripperoo and Qualcomm are like two different islands. Because I always kind of tend to think that, you know, since... Well, they're on the same island, but I kind of think, like, since they're both bosses, they would have their own island, you know? I'm used to that idea in video games where, like, every world has their own boss. Again, back to Mario, or maybe even Sonic, for that matter. Like, every zone has, like, its own boss, you know? And I like that idea. It just comes off a little weird when you actually notice it's like, wait a minute, Ripperoo and Koala Kong are on the same island. But then again, I always count Ripperoo as the part of Island 1 for some reason. Even though I know it's not, it clearly isn't, obviously. It's just I always tend to do that for some reason. Because, I mean, like, you go from up the creek to that, and I don't know. I also love how they... I love the level placement, too. Like, they kind of have these levels placed in a decent way. Like, you start off in the jungle, you know, and you kind of make your way to the gates and stuff like that. I mean, yeah, the gates and the jungle are two completely different things. They make no sense why they would be so close together, but... At the same time, like, you go up the creek, and you go up to Ripperoo. You know, that I actually think was a pretty cool, you know, level placement design, I think. Alright. Let's just let that thing blow up just in case, because I don't trust it. I don't trust this game. Oh god, I about got fucking squished there. I about got... About stilted my running. That would not have been good. Oh, piss! There it goes. I'm dead. I'm dead. More than likely, if you hit one, I think you're good. Now, this is a theory of mine. I don't know if it's true or not, but you know how these platforms kind of, like, go up and down, and they kind of go down, and... For some reason, like, I feel like whenever you jump downhill, you get further away from the boulder. And I don't know if that's true, but it feels like I do. And I completely screwed that up. It's gonna get me. It's going to... Yeah. I screwed up twice. That was basically a death sentence at that point. Problem is, you can't go back, unfortunately, but we're gonna go back, unfortunately. We're gonna have to go back. Ooh, man. Don't worry, guys. We get this one done. We get the... Great gate done, and I think we're finished with all the gems. Which I'm gonna be honest. I am so surprised with just my... I mean, I've 100% the game before. I have a file on here that says 100%. I don't know if you guys seen it or not, but I'll show you when we get the gem. And it's like, I've 100% it, like, I think once, maybe twice, at least. I remember the first time I 100%, I was like, yes, it's over! And then, you know, like, I did crash Let's Play, and I was like, I'm not gonna fucking 100% this. Fuck this game. I don't feel like doing that. And then, you know, here I am now, God knows how many years later, and here I am, just playing Crash again, and finally getting a chance to 100% it, you know? It's a good feeling, guys. It's a really good feeling. It really is. Oh, shit. Okay. My other theory, I don't know if this is correct either, besides, you know, the further, like, the more you jump, the further you get away. Well, if you jump downhill, but my other theory is, I think if you run diagonally, that, it's like, well, actually, that's pretty obvious. Like, if you run this way, if you run forward, and then you run to the left or right first thing, what the hell is that? You see that moving over there? See that, guys? How's that swinging? Oh, that's a platform, duh. Well, anyway, like, you know how, like, when I'm running these things, you have to, like, run diagonally? Well, actually, this is not a theory, it's more of actually a fact. Well, if you run to the if you run a hard right or hard left, you're gonna slow down because you're not moving forward. And thank God for freaking 360 directions. Holy shit! You know, some people would probably argue that this level's kind of a little bit of bullshit because of, like, where the placement of the stop signs are, or not the stop. Well, basically, where all the traps are, pretty much, like all the obstacles, like the placement. Some people might think the placements are bullshit. I don't really see that, because I feel like they give you plenty of time to look ahead before you actually get fucked over. So this is a weird level. As you see these bouncy crates here, yeah, make sure you bounce on them until you know that you're done with it. Like, you see that? Like, now I know I'm not coming down, so I automatically assume that there's nothing else left up there. Because for some reason, and I don't know why, I always feel like I miss something. I always feel like I'm missing something in this damn level. Oh god, there he is. Okay. Yeah, fuck you. I'm probably missing one up there. I'm gonna piss if I, you know, if I'm actually missing one or not. That would suck. But this is a strange area, though. It's cool looking, but strange looking too. Okay, so I still have plenty of time actually to get. I'm gonna go ahead and make a 30-minute video then. I guess I'll go ahead and try to complete the Great Gate in this amount of time because we have the yellow gem now. We also have the purple gem on hands too, but I don't think we really need to worry about that. Look at that! Look at this, guys. 8 episodes in and pretty much 100% done with the game. Now, of course, SGB did it a lot quicker than I did, but hey, you know, they did like 8 or 9 videos. I think I did mine like 8 or 9 videos. But I'm different. You know, I like to show everything off as much as I possibly can and just kind of show my fuck-ups until I fuck up too much, and that's when I don't show them. Yeah, so here we go, guys, the Great Gate. I have this weird OCD thing where I like to run back to the very beginning level and then start over again when I'm here. I don't know why I do that. It's just a weird habit. It needs to stop, but I don't get why. Okay, here we go. Maybe the Great Gate doesn't have that one box that's just hidden in the background. Maybe I did actually get the box on Native Fortress and just didn't know it. It's a possibility, guys. I don't know, actually. Or unless it's probably with the yellow gems, and I'm just a complete moron and have no idea about that. Bouncy, bouncy. Yeah, that... For some reason, like, whenever I bounce on the bouncy crates, and, like, whenever you hear, like, the Wumperfoot getting, like, sucked into you, you know, it almost sounds like it's saying bouncy, bouncy, bouncy. That kind of feels nice to say. I don't know why. I'm weird. Let's just state that as fact, guys. I'm just completely abnormal. Alright, here we go. And so far, so good. Of course, I remember you. I mean, why would I ever forget about you guys? Because you guys are always fucking there. Speaking of those guys, like, every time I see them, it reminds me of Twin Sanity. Like that one level where you're running with them tribemen. That game's actually pretty cool. I like that game. I remember hearing a lot of people didn't like it, but the music in that game is great. And I actually used that for my top 10 soundtracks. That was one of the soundtracks I really enjoyed because something about it, it's just, the way they make the music is just so interesting. I don't know how to explain it. Okay, let's go. It's like Sonic music, but just not really. Oh, fuck, there's a box right there. Problem with that box is I have to really try to get that one. Okay, here we go. This is where it's going to start. I'm pretty sure there's probably going to be a warp portal here, more than likely. Now, be careful of these back fences, though, because as you see, there's this life right here, but I can't get anywhere. Yeah, I can't do anything with that. Okay, so that's nothing. Just a life. It could have been a box, for all I know. It could have very well been a box. I can't go anywhere else, so let's just continue on. If the game screws me over for it, I'm gonna be pissed, because that's stupid. Now, more likely, there's probably a box here somewhere. Let's go find it. Jumping that way. We can go this way. So let's go this way, and then we'll head back. We'll have to go head back and get that bouncy crate. Okay, so far, so good. Granted, why did they even do this? Like, why did they even... Oh, there it is. It just gets in your way. It hilters your jump, or hilters your movement. There's nothing out... Okay, there's nothing over there. So we're going to head back. We're going to break the crate. Only problem is, I would have to... Wait a minute. Couldn't I just... No, I still have to break the crate, though. I don't think it really mattered. I wonder... That wouldn't work. I was thinking, like, maybe I can use the bouncy thing to get over to that platform. I don't think that would work. I guess since $9 are dicks, they want us to go ahead and do this the natural way. When I say dicks, I'm just joking. They're not dicks. They seem pretty cool. Except for, like, the whole Amy Henning thing. Like, what happened to that? Like, did she get fired or what? I don't even know. If you're wondering who that is, from what I understand, she was the writer of Uncharted. And a damn good one, too, if you ask me. It's like, that's... I don't know, like, I just... Uncharted 4's story I didn't really enjoy too much. I think it's mainly because of the brother being there too much, you know? Like, I kind of felt like it took the spotlight from Elena and Sully, because I really like those characters. But then again, you could say, like, well, what about Chloe? Fuck Chloe. She was... I mean, I like Chloe as a character, don't get me wrong. It's just, you know, like, she was... She made sense in where she was. Like, she wasn't there all the time, but there was still Elena, and there was still all the, you know, like, Sully and stuff like that came up. Well, I mean, even then, like, Sully doesn't really appear in most of the games anyway, that too much anyway. I mean, he was there in the first one, then Elena was there for, like, half the time, too, and then... Either way, I'm just saying, like, the brother just took too much of the spotlight, in my opinion. Like, what about Chloe? Like, I don't remember seeing her in 4, unless I just completely... I haven't played it for a while. I only beat it once, and that was it, which I actually am kind of wanting to play it again. And there you go. 100% completed, folks. All in a matter of 8 videos, which means, guess what? Donkey Kong's next. Oh, boy. That's fantastic, which means I'm probably going to have to record that this weekend. Oh, joy. Which, that won't be 100%, because I don't know how to 100% that goddamn game. I wish I did, but I don't know how. Before we end it off, I'm going to go one final bout through this and just kind of say what I feel about all these levels. Insanity Beach, easy, I like it, good first level. I like Jungle Rollers, that's a fun one. Great Gate, eh. Boulders, I like. Upstream, I like. Papu, yeah, of course, all the bosses. Rolling Stones, yeah, I like that one too. Hogwild, it took me a while, but I like it. Native Fortress, eh, I don't really like the gate ones that much. Up the Creek, I like. Ripperoo, eh, I don't know, just... No, I guess not all the bosses I like. Ripperoo and Qualicon, I don't know, just... Eh, kind of. Lost City, you can go fuck yourself. Temple Ruins, yeah, that's a pretty good one. Road to Nowhere, I like the design. Boulder Dash, I like the boulder ones. Whole Hog, yeah, sure, why not, I'll give it a pass. Sunset Vista, oh, God. Qualicon, Heavy Machinery, I like that one. Cortex Power, that's a cool one. Generator Room, don't really remember too much about it, but I know what it is, it's just not really, really memorable, I guess. Toxic Waste is a cool one. Pinstripe, you guys already know. The High Road, yes. Super Climb, Lights Out, yeah, that one's actually pretty easy. Fumbling in the Dark, nah. Jaws of Darkness, yeah, okay. Castle Machinery is okay. Natural Spiro, he's actually a pretty cool fight. And the Lab, ugh, the Lab. Next up, guys, is the Great Wall. Now, here's the thing. We saved the game, okay? We saved the game. You know what? I'm going to make this the one big finale because fuck this. I got this. What you can do, I'm going to do both, actually. This might be like maybe a 45-minute video. I don't know. We'll find out. There's only one way to tell. Here's the thing. You go into the Great Wall, and you can go straight to Cortex by using that warp pad, or you can finish off the game by using all the gems. Wait, what I could do. What do you think would be better? Either saving the girl... I got an idea. How about this instead? How about we kill Cortex off first, and then I'll show what happens if you go to the Great Hall with 100% completion. Now, let's go fight Cortex and make this just like the one big finale, because why the hell not? I always do this. Wait, that takes me to the map. Oh, because Dr. Cort... Okay. Because for no reason, it's there. I don't know if we can actually skip... I don't know if we can actually skip the credits or not. Probably not. Well, if we can't, then oh well. So basically, this is Cortex, and I will show up the Great Hall after this. He's a fun fight. He's actually a pretty memorable fight, if you ask me. It's pretty cool. Like, the Crash Bandicoot final bosses are always kind of fun, except for... I think it was... God, was it 2 or 3? No, 3 was cool. 3 was cool, because you had Aku and Uka Uka fighting each other. That was pretty badass. I like this one, but I think it was 2 was the one I didn't like. Because that was the one with the jetpack, I think. I don't know, something about it. I'm just going to get hit anyway. I kind of screwed myself up on that one. Oh, missed it. That's okay. We're doing just fine. Purple ones go straight towards you. Blue ones will either... completely miss you, or they will kind of like go up and down and bounce. It depends on where I guess you're shooting at. Now he's going to start shooting off these purple ones at rapid fire. So he's starting to get a little bit more pissed off at us. You want to hit the green one so you can kill a Cortex. That's 2. He's going to shoot 3 next time. Oh god. Oh wait, no, I guess it's 1. Oh, okay. Well, there you go. That's Cortex. He's done. Again, not really, you know, too hard of a final boss. Definitely a little bit more difficult than most. To be fairly honest, probably the most difficult boss you get, all things considered. Thing is, we save the day and do get Tana, and we basically burn down Cortex's castle and Whipple Islands. It's pretty much saved. Now here's the thing: we're not exactly completely finished yet. I don't see this as the best ending. This is the ending. It's not the best ending. So that was. Basically, Crash Bandicoot 1. And like I said before, this is not the complete ending yet, so I'm not really going to give my final thoughts on this just yet. I will wait until we get done. Granted, I could just quit the game, come back, but that could probably, more than likely, it will screw up my recording. So I'm not going to do that. Because if I quit, come back, then my 1080p will drop down to 480p, and that will pretty much ruin... Elgato, because that's what happened the first time I recorded, and I didn't know that. And I always forget to do that, too. I always forget about it. The good thing is about PS3, though, is I can sync it with my PS button. So that's not too bad, but at the same time, I wanted to show off the PlayStation logo because, God forbid, that's iconic. And I missed out on it, but, well, we're good, we're fine. It's okay, you guys know what's on. You guys can go and check out the PlayStation logo yourself. You've heard that thing, you've probably heard that thing a lot. It's like GameCube, you know, like you always hear it. That's another thing I do like. I kind of miss how consoles used to have that startup music that would play, like, you know, I think PlayStation 4, I don't know if that does it. I don't remember, actually. I think it does. I think PlayStation 4 has, like, some kind of startup thing going on. PS3 does. And GameCube and all that. I mean, I miss those. Like, the logos would come up, you know? That was always kind of cool, like, when you start a game and stuff like that. Well, that's pretty much the quote-unquote unofficial ending. You could basically... Or is that technically the legit first ending? I don't know. Look at that. Fucking Crash Bandicoot 2. Nah, it didn't say 100% or not. Wait, what the hell? Oh, yeah, okay. Wait. You'll tell me my percentage. Look at that, 86% done. What the fuck? 100% on both levels. But we're going to go to this one because that's when we started on, so... That's the more advised one, I guess. So go to the Great Wall. Great Hall, not Great Wall. When you get all the gems, you can basically take the gems to this little path here. And you can escape the castle with Tana in your arms and go off into the sunset to never be seen again. It's moments like these I wish I had a video camera. Then I would totally put in like a bad special effect to where it would show me walking off in the distance. That would be funny. But I don't have a camera, so kind of screwed on that one, aren't I? Basically, when you have all the clear gems, it will allow you access to the end of the game. And basically, you get the babe, and you just say, fuck Cortex, and escape. Because that's pretty much what we're doing here. Like, you don't save Wumpa Island, necessarily, or take down Cortex. But you do get Tana. Now, I think fighting Cortex is the legit ending. So I kind of did it backwards, but I'll just show off this as just an extra little bonus. As far as I'm concerned, I think that was the... Well, this one's just like an extra one. He sold the ruins of Castle Cortex to a resort developer. He then used the proceeds to open a big and tall shop on the island. But yeah, like, because in Crash 2, it continues off from when you defeat Cortex. So I think finding Cortex, is the legit ending. Hey, after intense therapy and 8 years of higher education, Dr. Rue went on to write the well-received book, Through the Eye of the Vortex, to study rapid evolution and its conscience. I didn't read that in time. And now we got to Qualcomm. Qualcomm moved to Hollywood and landed a motion picture deal of universal proportions. Currently, he's working with a speech therapist to improve his diction. Which, I didn't know he actually had a problem with that, though. Okay, well, whatever. It's actually cool. It's kind of nice how he's playable on Crash Bash. I like that. And they actually have a new enemy, too. Pinstripe moved to Chicago, where he now owns and operates a citywide sanitation company. He's saving money for his upcoming gubernatorial campaign. After the disappearance of his mentor, Dr. Nitrous Brio rediscovered his first love, tending bar. That makes a lot of sense. I mean, just look at this. You know, that's funny. Like, Crash, I think, came out before Spyro. But they look so similar, you know? They're so just unique and together. I love them. The world has heard nothing more of Cortex since Crash foiled his plans, but evil geniuses are harder to squash than cockroaches. More than likely. That's probably where they kind of give you the idea that there might be a sequel. And there more than likely will be a sequel. And guess what? There is a sequel. Came 1 year after Crash Bandicoot 1. And then Crash Bandicoot 3 came out 1 year after Crash 3. And I think it was like a couple years for Crash 4. Crash Bash came out after... Might have been a year or two. Crash Team Racing came out, I think, like maybe a year or two. And then it was Crash Bash. And then Crash 4, I believe, was the next one in the lineup. Unless the Game Boy ones came out then, I don't know. Either way, what do I think about Crash Bandicoot? Like, my honest, legit, 100% opinion at the moment. Well, I should say just in general. First game I ever played. Had so much nostalgia with this game. Again, I'm only 22, almost 23 years old, so of course it'd be my first. But do I think it's a good platformer? Hell yes. Do I love the challenge? Hell yes. I mean, is it hard to 100%? Hell yes. Is it fun? Hell yes. It's a great fucking platform. I know I said it kind of said that twice. But it's like whenever you play Mario or Mega Man, I feel like it's up there. I mean, it might not be a 2D side scroller, but it's a goddamn good platformer, that's for sure. You know, I feel the same way about Crash Bandicoot 1 as I feel about Spyro 1. They're a classic. They're just good. I can't exactly explain it. You have to play yourself. It's more of a subjective thing, but... You know, it's like whenever you play Donkey Kong Country, you beat it in like a day or whatever, and it's like, okay. But you can always find yourself going back and playing it again. Like, something about the simplicity of older classic games kind of makes it feel a little bit better, you know? And I mean, you could say, like, I do kind of miss simplicity in a sense, but now we're kind of going for a more story direction. I guess I'll show off what the options look like. Was there something else I was going to show off too that I completely forgot about? I don't think so. Probably not. Well, anyway, folks, that's it for Crash Bandicoot 1. There you go. You happy? I 100%. You guys happy now? Can I move on? Can I finally move on now? And go do Donkey Kong Country as my next Let's Play? Which will not probably be 100%, because I don't know anything about that game that much. I beat it once, and that was it. Well, my friend beat it while I played with him co-op. That might actually be co-op. I might have my friend guest star with me as a co-op adventure for that game. I might even have my brother with me too, just because, fuck him. But who knows? Well, anyway, this is the opening cutscene. I guess I probably should have shown this off too, but here you go. This is what happens when you wait. I mean, I'm not really going to cut my commentary here because what's the point? I'm sure you guys can probably kind of almost make out or kind of hear what's going on pretty much. As you can see, it's almost a little bit hard to explain. Basically, Cortex and Brio are working together to pretty much create mutations, and they're using animals from the island to do so. But Crash Bandicoot is such an idiot that he basically is, as the thing said, a reject. Unfortunately, they already have another Bandicoot that happens to be his girlfriend, and Crash broke out the window and now he's got to save his girlfriend, which they didn't really exactly necessarily explain that, but still. Which makes me wonder, why is Tana there in the bonus stages? Like, why can't we just take her and leave? Or does he know that she's there and he wants to just beat Cortex down and just take off with her no matter what and just have Cortex gone for good, you know, maybe? Or maybe she's dead and that's heaven. I don't know. Anyway, folks, once I get done Donkey Kong Country, I'll probably end up doing Doom 2016. I want to do Doom 1 this year sometime too, but I want to do 2016 first because it's a reboot. Fuck it. I feel like doing that. So anyway, I hope you all enjoyed. And I will see you guys in my next Let's Play. And as always, take care, everybody.